Our scripture reading this afternoon is from Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 to 25. Allow me to read for us from the ESV. Verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." And God made the expanse and separated the waters that were under the expanse from the waters that were above the expanse. And it was so. And God called the expanse heaven. And there was evening and there was morning, the second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the heavens be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Verse 11, and God said, "Let the earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seed and fruits, trees bearing fruit in which is their seed, each according to its kind on the earth." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed according to their own kinds, and trees bearing fruit in which is their seed, each according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. And God said, "Let there be light in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years, and let them be lights in the expanse of the heavens to give light upon the earth." And it was so. And God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night and the stars. And God set them in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning, the fourth day. Verse 20, and God said, "Let the waters swarm with swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the expanse of the heavens." So God created the great sea creatures and every living creature that moves, with which the waters swarm according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters in the sea, and let birds multiply on the earth." And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day. Verse 24, and God said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures according to their kinds, livestock and creeping things, and beasts of the earth according to their kinds." And it was so. And God made the beasts of the earth according to their kinds, and the livestock according to their kinds, and everything that creeps on the ground according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. Before I invite Pastor Vernon up to give the sermon, shall we pray for the children? Father, as the children head off for their CD class, and as they look to study the book of Judges, may we help them recognize the sin in our lives and help them to turn to King Jesus, who forgives all their sins. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Parents, you may send your children to their respective classes. And our speaker this evening is Pastor Vernon.
Good afternoon. It's good to see everyone here this evening. If you're new here with us, you're visiting, my name is Vernon, I'm one of the pastors here. It's a joy to have you with us. As you've heard from Deacon Nick, we've just started a new sermon series in the book of Genesis, so you've picked the right time to come and join us as we start in this series that's going to last us until November. This series will last us all the way to November. Please open your Bibles with me to Genesis chapter 1 if you haven't already. And as usual, there's an e-bulletin which you can get by scanning the QR codes in front of you on those pews if you haven't already. It's been almost 2 years since the 9th of September 2022, when the newly crowned King Charles III addressed his nation as King of the United Kingdom for the very first time. Not only the Commonwealth, but the entire world paid attention to King Charles's first words as king, because it was the very first time in more than 70 years, the first time in most of our lifetimes, that the British monarchy, the most famous of the world's monarchies, had a new sovereign. But we also paid very close attention to that first address, those first words, because not only were they an introduction to the king himself, but also an indication of what was to come in the days of his reign. Those very first words told us what was on his mind and his heart. They set the agenda for his reign, what he was committed to do. It's the same, although to a much lesser degree, much more recently, when just last month, the UK heard Keir Starmer's first speech as Prime Minister. Again, first words that not only introduced the new Prime Minister to a world that was generally unfamiliar with him, but also gave an indication as to what his and his government's agenda would be in the coming years, or possibly the coming months if you follow UK politics closely. If you're someone that doesn't really bother with what's happening in the UK, then surely our own new Prime Minister, Lawrence Wong's, his first words at his inauguration, less than 3 months ago, very recently, they mean much more to us as Singaporeans, don't they? His first words as Prime Minister that told us more about who our new, relatively less well-known leader is, but more importantly, what his new government is absolutely committed to. Something that we, every one of us here, should care about as people living in this island nation. You know, today, as we look at the very first words in the Bible, we're not just looking at the first words of an earthly king or a prime minister. No, we're looking at nothing less than the very first words of the Creator God himself, the Creator of all heaven and earth. And similarly to those other initial speeches, these first words we're about to look at, they tell us a lot about the Creator God, who he is and what he is committed to. Even from this very first part of Genesis, they reveal to us the Creator's agenda for what is to come. Genesis as a whole, but especially these first two chapters, they are absolutely foundational to all that God is doing in this creation. And like the foundation of any building project, once we see the shape, the form, and the magnitude of that foundation, we're able to much more make sense of this creation that all of us live in and are a part of. Now, I've read this creation account many times in my life, but I've never been more convicted than I am now about how critically, fundamentally important these words are to us today. Why don't we pause now and ask for the Lord's help to see just how important these words are. Please pray with me. Our Heavenly Father, our Creator, all those years ago, you gave these words to your people to not only know how all things began, but to know who you are. We ask that through Genesis, and especially through this creation account, that you will help us understand what you are still doing today and what you will ultimately fulfill in all of this creation. Please send us your Spirit now to work powerfully in us, that we might see your creation with fresh eyes, that we might be changed as we hear you speak. We pray this in the name of your Son, through whom all things are created. Amen. How would you begin the most important first words in all of history. Look with me again at verse 1, where God begins by making it crystal clear that the big heading of the entire creation account is this: in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. God created. It is He and no one else, certainly not any of the gods of Egypt, nor any of the other pagan gods in Moses' generation. It is God who created. And because He alone is creator, He alone is the one who should show us what creation is all about. Here's how He goes about doing so. After that big heading that He alone created, He shows us the start state of everything, what things looked like before He started creating. From verse 2, the earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. The earth was without form and void. Now, what comes to your mind when you think about a void? It's nothingness. Emptiness, isn't it? But it's actually really quite hard to conceptualize absolute emptiness. I don't think any of us can. So let's play a game. You know that game where I say a word and you say the first word that pops into your mind as a response? Okay, so I'll say a word and you say a word that pops into your mind. So let's play this game and let's just play one round and see if this works, okay? Say out loud the first word that pops into your mind when I say void. Say louder. Void. Okay, I'm gonna guess. Void deck. Anybody had void deck? Very Singaporean, very fun thing to think. Okay, here's a fun fact. Did you know that HDB void decks, the very first one was built in 1963, but it took a while for us Singaporeans to get our head around this concept of a void deck, and so they didn't become widely popular, they didn't become commonplace until the 70s. So it took 10 years, it took a full decade for HDB to convince people that void decks were useful. HDB void decks are a good little picture of what we're looking at here. Here's a question: what makes a void deck a void deck? What makes a void deck a void deck? Well, it isn't really anything about the void deck itself, is it? It's actually what isn't in the void deck that defines the void deck. And that becomes apparent when you look at every other floor of an HDB block above the void deck. Floors that have structures, floors that have forms, walls. The void is formless. That's what makes it a void. It's without structure. It's missing structure and order and form. God goes on to describe the pre-creation state another way. Darkness was over the face of the deep. You know, in context, the deep refers to the waters mentioned in the very next sentence, which makes sense, because if you've ever been scuba diving, you know how absolutely terrifying deep waters are. Waters, again, without form and structure. You know, I'm not someone who scares easily, if you know me, but one of the most terrifying things I've done in my life is to go scuba diving at night in the open ocean, where your powerful underwater torch, the thing that you're really, really impressed by before you get into the water, it goes no further than 2 meters in front of you, and then nothingness. Absolute pitch dark blackness. You know, the scariest parts of my night dives were when nothing was close enough to see, where you're surrounded by emptiness and formlessness all around you, 360 degrees. Or when my buddy, the dive instructor, kind of gets a bit too far and his light just gets too far away for comfort and you're suddenly cold and alone. But that also meant that there was always a sense of relief when the dive finished and you were ascending to the end, right? Here's a screenshot. I don't know if you can see it. It's one of the screenshots of a video of one of my night ascents. You can make out the little bubbles there. And there's a little light there if you look at it. That light is actually the moon. There was a full moon out that night when I was ascending. And so there's a huge release when you break the surface and you have light suddenly from the depths of darkness. But imagine with me for a moment now, if there was no light to ascend to. If all that was over the face of the deep was darkness. How hopeless, how frightened would you feel if you were in those waters and there was no light anywhere at all? That's the pre-creation state. This formless void, this emptiness, this darkness, the pre-creation state is actually terrifying if you think about it. There's such a sense of hopelessness and nothingness to it. Except for one thing. The Spirit of God was right there in all that darkness, hovering over the face of the waters, getting ready to change everything from hopelessness and nothingness and darkness, getting ready to create. We're at point number two in the outline, the order of creation. You know, there are probably a limitless number of ways that God could have described creation if you think about it. So it's quite surprising that what we have in front of us here in Genesis 1 is a relatively short creation account, isn't it? I want you to notice just how structured and deliberate this beginning of the account of creation is. In fact, the whole book of Genesis is highly ordered and creation and structured. Look with me here. See if you can spot the repetition throughout this whole book from Genesis 2 verse 4. That's the first of these repeated structural markers. Genesis 2 verse 4. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created. In the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens. This structural marker is repeated again and again and again throughout the whole book of Genesis. 5 verse 1, this is the book of the generations of Adam. 6 verse 9, of the generations of Noah. 10 verse 1, the generations of the sons of Noah. 11 verse 10, of Shem. 11 verse 27, of Terah. And in the second half of the book, in chapter 15, of Ishmael and then of Isaac. In chapter 36 and 37, of Esau and then of Jacob. You see, this entire book is meant to convey how intentional God is as He organizes, as He orders the telling of this creation account, the telling of history of the generations of the heavens and the earth, and in particular, of the generations of Adam, whose name means mankind itself. This deliberate ordering, it is found all throughout the creation account. And this deliberate ordering is found in our passage today, too. Let me highlight three repetitions in this text that tells you that God is deliberately ordering, intentionally ordering this creation account. The first of the three repetitions. The first and the most obvious one, found repeatedly through our text, goes like this. Genesis 1 verse 5, and there was evening, and there was morning, the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth day. And so the deliberate structure of Genesis 1 verse 1 to 2 verse 3 are 7 days, the 7 days of creation. Many commentators, including the French theologian Henri Blocher, they have noticed that the first 6 days of creation can be further grouped into two halves. Days 1 to 3, and then days 4 to 6. I've tried to represent this structure in two halves in this diagram, and I've included that in the outline. But notice with me that days 1 to 3 are the form or the structure, and days 4 to 6 are God filling that form or that structure. In day 1, from verses 3 to 5, God says, let there be light, separating the light and the darkness. He calls the light day and the darkness night. In day 2, from verses 6 to 8, God creates an expanse to separate the waters under the heavens from the waters above. He calls that expanse heaven. In day 3, from verses 9 to 13, he gathers the waters under the heavens together to form dry land, which he calls earth. And he creates all manner of vegetation and plants and fruit trees on that earth. And so God creates the form and the structure of creation in days 1 to 3. And then in days 4 to 6, he proceeds to fill the structure he's created. Day 4, in verses 14 and 19, he creates the lesser lights and the greater lights in the heavens to separate night and day respectively, to rule the day and the night respectively. In day 5, from verses 20 to 23, he creates living creatures, fish to fill the seas, the waters under heavens, and birds to fill the expanse, what he calls the heavens. And on the sixth day, which we're only looking at the first half of today, he creates all kinds of living creatures to fill the dry land, the earth. Do you see that? Days 4 to 6 all perfectly match up with days 1 to 3. He is filling those 3 days. Do you see how highly ordered, how deliberately structured this account is? But why? What is he pointing us towards? Well, anyone in this hall today who's recently done renovations on their HDB flat will recognize this process. What's the first thing that you do when you get keys to your HDB? What's the first part of the renovation process? Well, you work on the structure first, don't you? That might mean for you, if you got a resale flat, means knocking down or building walls, depending on the start state of your unit. But once the form, the structure is done, what do you do next? You start filling that structure, don't you? You start filling it with fixtures like lights and appliances, built-in furniture. And then what happens? Well, you start filling it, maybe eventually, with living things like plants or animals. Does that sound familiar? Well, you see, the way that you build any construction progress, this is the OG, the original construction project. You build the form, the structure, and then you fill it in any construction project. But friends, make no mistake, this is not your HDB flat that we're talking about. You know, if you get a landed property and you have to build it up from scratch, the process is exponentially more complicated, right? Because you have to design the whole structure from scratch. Now imagine building not just one house, but designing and structuring a whole neighborhood, or a whole city, or an entire nation, or a whole planet, or the entire universe, realms of heaven and earth. And you get a little glimpse of what we're seeing. What we're seeing in these first words is beyond anything that we are capable of forming and filling. We are looking at one who is fundamentally above us, greater than us, higher than us. There are 2 more repetitions in our text today that we should briefly take note of. Repetition number 2. And God said, let there be light, let there be an expanse, let the waters and let the earth. And every single time he says it, what happens? It was so. Again, do not miss the magnitude of what is being created by the power of God's words here. God's words is authority that all of creation recognizes rightly and responds to. And again, make no mistake, what is happening here is fundamentally above the power of you and my words. Your words and my words do not hold this kind of authority. If you don't believe me, you probably don't have young children. Because the default state of young children will very quickly dispel you of any delusion you may have that your words have any power at all. You can say something again and again and again, and most of the time, you're doing well if they even remember what you said at all. let alone if they listen and obey. And it was so. If you don't believe me, Ruth and I will be very happy to arrange for you to have a little first-hand experience to convince you. Friends, God says it once, and it is so. The power of His Word is what makes creation itself happen. And we need to spot that deliberate repetition in our text. A third repetition. Finally, the third and last repetition is God's repeated declaration as He looks at His creation, that He saw it and He declared it to be good. 7 times He declares this, and I think the point being made in this particular repetition is that He, as the Creator, is the one, the only one, who has the right to decide what is good in His creation. He is committed to this good creation and is communicating through the creation account His rightful place in determining what is good. He's telling us just how good creation was from the beginning, and that He is the one who can rightfully call all things in creation good. We're going to see more of this next Sunday. In fact, all 3 of these repetitions, the morning and evening of the days, the repeated God saying and it becoming so, and the final declaration of it was very good. All 3 of these repetitions find their climax at the end of next week's passage in Genesis 1, 29 to 31. Let me highly encourage you to come back next week to see where all of this is going. But for now, repetitions and deliberate, intentional structure. Why? Why is God so careful with these, His very first words? Well, come back to me to where we began. Well, these first simply are an introduction. And they are a key introduction. See, we as Christians believe that Moses wrote these words, not only Genesis, but Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, collectively the Pentateuch, the first 5 books of the Bible. And he wrote it in the midst of the Exodus generation. Now, this is a fundamental change from all the generations that had come before. Because how did the generations before come to know God, Yahweh God? Well, He spoke to them, individuals and individual families. But for the first time in Exodus, for the first time in Moses' generation, this is God's written word that He writes down for the purpose of His people. This is God's introduction to His corporate people. Not only that first generation, the Exodus generation, but remember what happened to that generation? Well, every single one of them, less Moses and Caleb and Joshua, they died. And so He needed to write it down so that the second generation and every generation since of His people would know Him. That's the other repetition that you're going to see throughout Genesis. This is a sign of the covenant that I make between me and you, Genesis 9. For all future generations, I will establish my covenant between me and you throughout your generations, Genesis 17. Genesis 17, as for you, you shall keep my covenant, you and your offspring after you through their generations. God is writing these things, being very deliberate and careful of His first words, because this is His introduction. These are the words that every generation of His people, including us today here, need to know God. So what exactly does God want His people to know? Well, let me draw 3 applications or 3 observations particularly for what the structure I think tells us. Well, firstly, very obviously, God is the powerful Creator. He is the powerful Creator. And His power sets Him fundamentally apart from everyone else. Some commentators call Him the uncreated one, the one and only uncreated one. He is fundamentally above all creation. And if you remember the magnitude of which He creates, and his rightful place in declaring all things good, ruling over that creation, naming that creation, forming and filling that creation. Well, he is holy. He deserves all glory. Well, this observation, these three observations actually, they will give us three fundamental pillars, three anchors that we're going to need for not only the rest of Genesis, but for the rest of the whole Bible story. These three anchors are the fundamental basis of how we understand God's story. God is the creator. He deserves his rightful place as the uncreated one. First observation. Observation number two. He is the God who creates, and not only creates form and structure as if that wasn't jaw-droppingly powerful enough, he is utterly committed to multiplying and filling that creation. Did you notice that in days 4 and 6? In days 4 and 6, he's utterly committed to filling the form and the structures of creation. Now, surely, this tells us something about this God today. It tells us something about this, his view of this world, his creation today. As he sees it, he is still utterly committed, even from the very first day of creation, to fill his complete cosmos. He is working towards something. He didn't spend all that effort building just for the sake of it. He is still working to fill the heavens and the earth with something. Third observation. Well, this creator God is the God who creates by speaking. It's very strange if you think about it. Wouldn't you expect some kind of action, some kind of molding or doing as God creates? We'll see a little bit next week. But primarily in this first 5.5 days of creation, God speaks. His word is powerful. Now, those of us who know the whole Bible story will know exactly where this leads us, to his word, through whom he created, by whom he creates, not only created, but sustains all of creation today. From the very get-go, from the very first page, God wants his people to know and have confidence that his word is powerful. His word is the way that he creates and sustains and completes. And so these three fundamental observations. Well, there are two big teasers I want to flesh out. We usually say that when we approach something new, it's helpful to ask 5 W's and 1 H. Have you heard this model before? The who, the what, the where, the when, the why, and the how. That's generally the case when you approach a new subject. If you approach this subject that way, well, it's quite clear that God is prioritizing one of those things, the who. God is the creator. He's introducing himself to his people. The who is elevated in this creation account. Now, many have come to these first pages of the Bible seeking to answer questions about how, about when, about where. And you have to understand that fundamentally, this doesn't seem to be God's purpose in these pages. If they are a comprehensive textbook of how he created, then you must realize that this is a terrible how account. This is a terrible explanation of how God created, because he doesn't explain much at all. But if you keep focus and remember that this is the who, this text is not meant in that first generation primarily to be an apologetic defense of how God created the earth. It wasn't meant to refute all our modern scientific claims of creation. That's not God's purpose in writing this text. He has a far greater and more important purpose for his people. He wants us to know who he is. And if we remember that, well, we'll know how to read Genesis 1 and all the chapters to come in Genesis after this. a second big teaser for next week. You know, if you were building a house and you went through months and possibly years of the pain of house building, of renovating and contracting and filling, why do you go through all that trouble? Why do you make all that effort? Why do you build this? Well, we're about to see why in the coming weeks. We're about to see a God who is utterly committed to building forms and structures, filling those forms and structures so that he can come and live in that creation. Just like you, if you were building a house. This is God's big purpose. Tune in to find out more. Well, three observations, two teasers for next week, one big conclusion. What do you think as you look at who God is, the God who is powerful, the uncreated creator, the God who creates and is committed to multiplying and filling that creation, the God who creates powerfully through his word? What do you think your one response should be tonight? Well, all glory and praise to God is to give him his rightful place in our lives, the one thing that is missing in our world today, the one thing that we exist for. And so that's where we're headed in Genesis. That's what this creation account was meant to point us towards. And so why don't I give us a moment to personally do that as we respond to this Creator God. And then we're going to pray, and we're going to stand and sing the rightful praise that he deserves to our Creator. Why don't you take a moment now to speak to our God. Our dearest Heavenly Father, our Creator, you are the one and only Creator of all. And so you deserve all glory and the praise of all creation. Father, thank you for being a God who so deliberately, intentionally, orderly revealing himself to us, to your people. And even as we see you revealing yourself in creation, lead us to your Son, your word, and help us respond rightly now in praising you and him with our words and with our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please rise for the response song.